Our third speaker is Ben McDonald, and he represents Alternatives North. And Alternatives North had its 30th anniversary, was it last year? 20th anniversary last year. But it's been an amazing organization that's brought together so many thinking people here in the North to talk about the issues on a voluntary basis. You know, and Ben has been a big part of that for those 20 years, and he's worked through the unions, worked in many ways. He's retired now, which means that he gets to work for free all the time. And I'm really glad that he's here to speak today. So, Ben McDonald.
Thank you, Dennis. I'm probably going to have a bit different presentation than the others that were heard. As Dennis said, is the speaking okay on this now? Because I
Dennis has to turn his mic on.
Yeah, okay, thank you. I sound like
just
a
hold that close.
Okay, I can just hear him. The Alternative North, as was said, has been around for about 20 years, and we're a social justice coalition that involves environmental groups, poverty groups, women's organizations, labor and church groups, and other small businesses and individuals. We have been trying to influence public policy in the North since inception for about 20 years, both, I guess, in the Northwest Territories and nationally. With few exceptions, the people of the North ascribe to the five principles of the Canada Health Act. There are people who are promoting greater private delivery of services, especially in Yellowknife, but across the Northwest Territories. People that believe that that services, therapeutic services and other issues like that are moving more and more, are becoming more and more available in Yellowknife. The market outside of the city, though, there is no market for private services, and you're very rare to see anything in the private field outside of Yellowknife and probably the bigger communities in the other territories. We are firmly committed to the idea that the private system is not an efficient and effective way to deliver it. As you said, and as other people have said, our only hope for a quality second phase in the healthcare system is to do it through the public system. A few Northerners believe that there is a likelihood that we're going to see like a family practice doctor in every community, let alone a range of specialists. That being said, Northerners still expect that they're going to have equitable access to the healthcare system that other Canadians enjoy. If we can't put the services in the communities, then we may have to continue to bring the people to the services. And under the Canada Health Act, only physicians' services and hospital services are paid for. And it could well be that the only way we're going to provide service in the more remote communities is for the healthcare service system to provide transportation services for probably not only in the North, but also in remote rural locations. If you can't take a doctor to the person, you have to take the person to the doctor or the physiotherapist or whoever else. I reviewed the paper, the discussion paper that you held up, that you have the color version of, and much in that, I think Alternatives North would ascribe to we're in favor of the 6% escalator and a new accord that puts standards on the 13 jurisdictions to make sure that Canadians are actually getting equitable and similar services across the country. But we're also in favor of the idea of the long term, of the need for a strategy around long term home care, so that we can get the people that are presently inappropriately in hospital beds, taking up hospital beds, or taking up other high cost facilities, to get them into more appropriate treatment services. An area that we probably do have some problems with in the paper is in the area of the drug plan. It appears from reading at this, and you can clarify that for me if I have misinterpreted it, but it appears that it's tending in the direction of a catastrophic plan that was more conceived in 2004. Okay, well, that's very good to hear, because it's quite clear that the evidence is is that, you know, $25, $27 billion can be saved with the universal plan. If we deliver drugs to Canadians and to people who need drugs in Canada in the same way we do deliver hospital and doctor services, $25 to $27 billion could be saved. I take that back. $10 billion could be saved.
That's right.
$10 billion could be saved. As a social justice coalition, we are most interested in the social determinants of health, and that's an area that a number of speakers have spoken on already, including yourself. We believe that a healthcare system that is not based on an equitable society, democratic controlled systems, fully involved and participating members of the community is doomed to failure. And that the growing tendency towards inequality in Canada is clearly a problem for healthcare, and our national government has to do its part to make sure that that we lessen inequality so that people can have a healthy and fully rich life. Specific issues in the Northwest Territories. Well, I should, if I could just in passing say that Alternatives North has been involved with a bunch of organizations trying to promote a anti-poverty strategy in the Northwest Territories. And we believe that the national government should be taking the lead on this. We should be having an anti-poverty strategy at the national level that that incorporates the plans that are already either in development or that are developed in the territories and provinces. A couple of specific items that I think deserve special attention from the North, and I said you could well correct me on this one. This is like the Cantonese side, but housing is a critical issue here. You know, one in five houses in the North housing units are in core need, which means they're suitable, unsuitable, inadequate, and the people don't have enough money to pay for it. 15% of houses in Northwest Territories are in need of a major repair. And those sorts of issues, you can't, as Dr. Corriveau said, you can't have a healthy population if you have inadequate housing, drafty housing, moldy housing. So a national program, if the New Democratic Party wants to deal with health issues, it should deal with the housing issue in the country. And there are a variety of ways that can be done. We can talk about that if there's any interest in doing so. Another issue that is difficult, I think especially difficult for the remote communities, is starting at Yellowknife and going up from here, is the need for support for the cost of living, for more assistance in getting especially nutritious and healthy food into the communities so that people have got good diets that allow them to be healthy. Current food subsidy programs for providing food into the communities are just not working. The costs are outrageous and people cannot afford to have a healthy diet. I'd like to speak about a couple of specific programs that are operating in the North. One is the non-insured health benefits program. I was talking to people that have to operate or have to deliver services under the the non-insured health benefits for status Indians and Inuit. And the program seems to have administrative problems. Doctors and therapists are want to prescribe something for either an appliance or something like that that's eligible underneath the NIHB, have to have their recommendations quite often or commonly, if not always, examined by an outside consultant. And that sometimes the outside consultant would then come back to the practitioner and say that they need further information. And by that time, if the person is from Wati, the person from Wati is gone and just chaos ensues. So the practitioners have a very difficult time administering the NIHB as it is. And it seems like the most of the problems is that the bean counters are in control, they're not actually delivering a health service. The people at the top are most interested in cost control, are more interested in cost control than they are in service delivery. I think that's an issue that the federal government need to pay attention to. Another big issue in Northwest Territories is mental health. There's been allusions to that. Partially, that is because of the colonial background that we experience here, and it comes from the heritage or the leftovers, I guess, from the residential school system. I spoke to some consultants that do counseling, and I've got some information from them that I'll give you references and other issues like that that will help you to understand the sorts of problems that are here. Millions of dollars are spent on treatment, but everybody in a relatively small system, I think $9 million was spent on addiction services or mental health services in the communities, and everybody's complaining it's not enough. I mean, and that's just all there is to it, that we have serious problems, especially related to addictions and sexual assault and the other issues that were there. And the federal government needs to take into account, I think, when it's developing its health policy, it has to take into account the reality of the North, the cross-cultural colonial nature of it. And this includes huge swaths of the country, the northern provinces, as well as the territories. A final issue that I'd like to mention is that the issue around human resources. I read the document, the innovation document, and it seems to me that although they address the issue of human resources, it seems to me to be sort of on a very superficial level. We'll trade information and we'll talk about ways of trying to stop competition, but I think more effort and more attention has to be put into that field. A mental health worker that goes into a community faces burnout. There are quite often one or two people in the community, especially in a smaller community, expected to do 7 days a week, 12-hour care. I mean, they've got office hours, but they're the only person there. So burnout is a huge problem. The isolation that they experience and the lack of opportunities for professional development also mitigate against them staying there. A person spends a little bit of time in the community providing these services, and they have to get out before they crack themselves. There was another element to that. I spent some time to put together a brief, and I'll submit that through Ben or through Dennis, and you can look at that afterwards. I think that in summary, except for, I mean, you can fix me up on the pharmacare thing. We would generally ascribe to the alternative north, would generally support the direction that the NDP has taken, with the view to saying the federal government's got a critical role to play in this, it's got to put money into it, it's got to put leadership into it. The second aspect of the takeaway that I'd like you to have is that any national program that does not have special programs to address the reality in remote communities is bound to fail us. Thank you.